What is this? Okay. Maybe it's okay. We are live on Facebook.
So I really, is anybody in there? Because the whole point is to show them, not us.
No one's in there yet, just us.
So I would go to the view of, what is it called, where everybody shows.
The grid view.
Yeah, because we really want to see them as a part of the community. Hi, Facebook, welcome.
Okay. Maybe.
Okay. those that are out in our virtual viewing, it's a delight to have you all with us. Holy Eucharist, Rite 2 begins. It's written in your bulletin. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever.
Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High. Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, and the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be
with you. And also with you.
Almighty and everlasting God, you are always more ready to hear than we to pray, and to give more than we might desire or deserve. Pour upon us the abundance of your mercy, forgiving us those things of which our conscience is afraid, and giving us those good things for which we are not worthy to ask, except through the merits and mediation of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the book of Exodus. God spoke all these words. I am God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God has given you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox, or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. When all the people witnessed the thunder and lightning, the sound of the trumpet, and the mountain smoking, they were afraid and trembled, and stood at a distance, and said to Moses, "You speak to us, and we will listen, but do not let God speak to us, or we will die." Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid, for God has come only to test you, and to put the fear of him upon you, so that you do not sin." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm is Psalm 19. Let's read this together. Heavens declare
It comes forth like a bridegroom out of his chamber. It rejoices like a champion who runs a course. It goes forth from the uttermost edge of the heavens. And runs not back to the end of the game. Nothing is hidden from its birth or end. The law of the Lord is perfect. It revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, and he gives wisdom to the innocent. The statutes of the Lord are just, and rejoices the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear, and gives life to his eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true, and righteous altogether. More to be desired than the Lord. More than much fine gold, sweeter more than honey, than honey can become. By them also is what's heard in my life, and in keeping them there is great reward. You can tell how often you give thanks. Cleanse me from my secret faults. Thou wilt keep your servant from his unjust sins. Let him not make the new sound, and listen for prayer of faith. The meditation of my heart is acceptable in your sight. Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Philippians. If anyone else has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born to Hebrews, still a leader of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. Yet, whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things, and I regard them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ. Righteousness from God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings by becoming like him in his death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already attained this or have already reached the goal. I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went away to another country. When the harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his slaves and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, they will respect my son. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance. So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Now when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? They said to him, he will put those wretches to a miserable death, and lease the vineyard to other tenants, who will give them the produce at the harvest time. Jesus said to them, have you never read in the scriptures, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone? This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes. Therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruits of the kingdom. The one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone on whom it falls. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard this parable, they realized that he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowds because they regarded him as a prophet. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So let's think back to when we were little for a moment. And if you were part of church at all, you may remember there were a lot of kids in church. Remember that? I know I was in the Baptist church, and so there was, you know, when we had vacation Bible school, it was amazingly, like, huge amount of kids. And that was true in all churches, frankly, in all Christian churches. You know, we always talk about back in the day, right? When the sanctuaries were full, families were, you know, there were tons. There was no shortage. And that says a lot about where Christianity fell in the mind and the heart of society, at least in our country, for the most part. And a lot has changed. And you'll hear a lot of controversy about why it's changed. Some of it may be true, some of it not so true. But I do think it's important for us to be thinking about what the change is about. You know, we have these Ten Commandments, which we all know, hopefully. But if you were to ask kids about them, I don't know that they would know. You know, some of the main stories in Scripture, I'm not so sure they know about Jonah or Noah or Moses. Some of our kids hopefully would, but we don't know, right? That kind of, those primary stories were part of our being growing up. They were the stories that we heard in Sunday school and in vacation Bible school. The Ten Commandments. Kind of the cornerstone, if you will, of the Old Testament. And they were written on a stone tablet. And so they were the ones that held that the law of God that says, four of these commandments are about your and my relationship, God and God's people, and the rest of the six are about relationship to others and self. And these will be your guiding posts. These will be the ways that you will know that you're my people, and others will know you are my people. And then we get to the New Testament, and we have Jesus now, who Jesus is now the chief cornerstone. It's not that we just throw away the Ten Commandments, because they still abide as a part of what God is about, and who we are as God's people, and how we relate to God and to each other. But Jesus being the chief cornerstone. And it's an interesting parable, and we can read a lot into this, and I'm going to try not to do that. But the one question Jesus leaves us with, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? Now, their answer was, put them to a miserable death. Now, that was their answer. Jesus was the one that said that. So, you know, it says something about how they experienced God. And Jesus is staying focused on the stone that is being rejected. And the relationship with the tenants, of who are the tenants. And I think we need to be asking that because you and I are tenants of the church, if you will. And so what does that say about our role, our responsibility in being the tenants? You know, what are we doing with the fruits of God's work? And how are we returning and giving back to all that God has put us in charge of, if you will? And I think that it's hard to think about it in terms like that because we don't necessarily live in a world where, you know, this kind of relationship between owners and tenants exists, unless you're in a, you know, we'd have to translate that into some kind of an American metaphor. But it's still important for us to think about, and I really think that my concern, and I don't mean to, I wasn't, my intention was not to come here and talk doom and gloom here about the church, because I really believe there's a whole other change happening. But here's the thing, right? Part of what's happening in the church mirrors, and we see in society that rise in violence and the rise in discord and the rise in those things that we step back and we're like, if we talked like that when we were kids, we know what our parents would have done, right? And it's like this whole different way of thinking and being in the world has very little to do with the ingrained, embedded messages of relationship with God. And so I feel like there's a part of that that's kind of disappearing from the mass mindset. Our job is to remember, tell the story, remind others there's a bigger story here. St. Francis of Assisi gives us a roadmap for that. I want to talk about him because I think that his life is one of those that stands out as a model for the journey of Christianity, of being a Christian. He grew up in a very rich family back in the 12th century. And loved it. Typical, even for today, kind of stereotype of the rich young, you know, man. Out there having fun, loving his life, doing everything he could do because he had the means to do it. And he wanted to become a knight. That was like, you know, another trophy he could put on the wall. And so he joined the military. What he wasn't anticipating was becoming a POW, and he became a POW. And during that time, I don't know a lot about what happened to him, but I can imagine it was a pretty dark time, because nothing, no riches were going to help him during that time of being enslaved. He was free, I think about a year and a half later, became really sick and went back to Assisi, and he became really sick for a while. And during that time, he, between his POW years and his illness, he had visions. God gave him some visions during that time. And it really changed his life and his understanding. This is not uncommon. One of the reasons I loved hospital work is because when people are in the hospital and they know their vulnerability, they're ready to go deep and ask some really deep questions about God. And what is it all about, right? What's this all about? And what is their life about? Why am I here? And he left everything. He left everything. Didn't take a dime. Not sure he had much clothes on his back when he just left. And he became well known, obviously, and was a staunch lover of love. And he loved people, he loved animals. There's some anecdotal stories about him around animals. But completely changed his life. The Franciscans he created at that time, and was out there changing the world. But it wasn't through wealth. Now, we're not all called, and I get that, to just walk away from our life. But it's a story of power. And that's the thing I want to really get across, is the kind of power, the laws, the chief cornerstone that God has laid before us is about one type of power, and it's the power of love. It's the power of the cross. And what do we do with that? What is the foundation upon which our faith is built, our lives are built? You know, what is holding the whole together? Because that's what the cornerstone does. It's the one stone. If there's going to be a building at all, you got to have it. Because without it, everything crumbles. And that is so important for us as disciples to be clear about, because that's what we're teaching by our lives, our examples, hopefully by the ways that we are in relationship to the world around us, to people around us, how we share God's love, how is that leading us and guiding us, how is that the roadmap for all that we are, all that we will become. And not only for ourselves, but for the church. I don't know what the church is going to look like in 50 years, but I know what it looks like today. And we're here, and we're still called. We're still called. And we may get rejected. It doesn't mean God leaves them alone. Because I believe God calls every human being into relationship. And we have a particular message to tell the world about Jesus Christ, the one that holds the love of the world together, through whom we live and move and have our being. Amen.
Amen.
Today. Oh, it's the words of the Nicene Creed.
Yeah.
Because I can barely believe in one God, the Father of the world, and the maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father.
God from God, light from light, true God from true God. Begotten, not made, one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end.
We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life,
who proceeds from the Father and the Son. with the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets.
We believe in one holy and Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Using Form 6, encourage the people as printed in the worship of the Lord. Let us pray for the church and for the world. In peace we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and work.
For our enemies and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For this community of labor, the nation and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble. For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek.
For Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury. Michael, our presiding bishop. Paulson, our bishop. Daniel, Bishop of Europe. And the clergy and people of Oklahoma. And our companion diocese of Louisville, and those in our deacon body, and all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God in the church,
for the special needs and concerns of this congregation, for those serving our country at home or abroad in that fashion, for those who are in hospitals while pushing and rearing, for those who need healing, Avery, Susan, Michael, Ryan, Mary, Lisa, Dina, Carolyn, Greg and Mary, Vicki, Corey, River, Ann, Danny, Billy, Eric, Bob, Buster, Terry, Corey, Cindy, and Vicki. Also, we pray for all impacted by the coronavirus pandemic. The first lady, Dr. Mary Trotz. And for the first responders, doctors, nurses, techs, custodians, researchers, and decision makers. For those who are waiting for results, those who are sick, those who are dying with their families. We continue to pray for teachers, students, families, and administrators as they gather for the school year. And seek to provide safe and effective learning environments. Prayers for the bereaved, especially for Phyllis and her family, while still Conway and her family. Also, pray for all impacted by coronavirus. Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life, for those celebrating birthdays this week at Pentecost. And for those celebrating the anniversaries this week, Bill and Ian Peterson, we will exalt you, O God, our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all, O God, that they may have a place in the eternal kingdom. Pray for the departed of Christ, Alvin Farrell, Larry Smith, and Kathy Conner. We remember Steve and Judy, for whom all the flowers are given by their leadership. Lord, let your love and kindness be upon them.
We put their trust in you.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us,
most merciful Father, in your compassion forgive us our sins, known and unknown, being saved by death, and so uphold us by your Spirit. That we may live and serve you in the newness of life. To the honor and glory of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins, for the glory of Jesus Christ. strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you. Stand if you so wish it. Good to see everybody. Peace, everybody. Peace out there in virtual land. It's a delight again to have you spend and share your time with us today on this really beautiful day. And it is so beautiful that we're going to do Blessing of the Animals at 3 o'clock today. So for those who are comfortable, bring a lawn chair, and we'll gather out here on 17th Street lawn. And then for those who would like to bring their animals and put your giraffe in your car, you know, we'll bless over here as you drive by. So bring the furries and those sweet little cuddly stuffed animals too, because I know there's some little ones out there. Mine would be bringing them, sure. So we'll be a fun time by all. Anything else that I need to say? I want to bring your attention to the votive stand. What you will not see, however, is candles and matches. But instead of using, because that we could not find a safe way to use the candles, we are going to be using water. So there's individual water bottles down here. The waters will be representative of your prayers before the votive. And lot of theological and spiritual, you know, water contains, you know, so many elements of our spirituality. So feel free to do that. And keep the bottle or set the bottle back there somewhere. We need to get a van to put it in a trash can. So that was the reason, so that you can touch without, you're the only one touching. And you're free to take a bottle of holy water home with you as well, if you so desire. Anything else? Any other announcements? Stay connected to one another out there and stay safe. Walk in love as Christ loved us, gave himself for us in an offering and a sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
Eucharistic prayer A to be found in the bulletin is this. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right to be good and joyful thing. Always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Who on the first day of the week, Father, came to bed and prayed, and by his Lord's resurrection, opened to us the way of God. Bringing our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn, to proclaim the glory of your name. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you have your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and rise one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and the Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ is dying. Christ is risen. Christ is still coming in. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace, and at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of the eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. May all the sacred hearts have taught us in their bold pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us today our daily bread.
Our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
What are you watching?
Saturday Night Live.
Hallelujah, Christ.
I shall be altered on this.
Jesus,
we're all about
the God. Take the remembrance of Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. For those of you who cannot be with us today, let us pray. In union, blessed with Jesus, with the faithful gathered at the altar, we offer you praise and thanksgiving for all the blessings of this life, for the redemption won for us by your life, death, and resurrection, the means of grace and the hope of glory. We believe that you are truly present in the Holy Sacrament, and since we cannot at this time receive communion, we pray you to come into our hearts. We unite ourselves with you and embrace you with all our hearts, souls, and mind. Let nothing separate us from you. Let us serve you in this life until by your grace we come to your glorious kingdom and unending peace.
Amen.
And the peace of God which passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you this day and always.
Go in peace, in love, and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Please feel free to stay.